easy Patreon. So in this video, I kind of thought it might be worth doing a track breakdown. This track is going to be my next release. It's coming out on, I can't even say the name of the label because we haven't even worked out what we're going to call it yet. But it's going to be a compilation EP with myself, Hieroglyphics, Drone, and Jook. And yeah, this track, in my opinion, has kind of changed a fair bit from its initial inception. And I kind of thought it might be worth kind of showing you guys how I found a sample, which I really like the sound of. And at first I wanted it to sound a certain way. And then given the circumstances, it's kind of changed into one thing. And then the final product slightly changing again into something else. So yeah, we're gonna kind of just go over the first idea I had and then the main initial idea I kind of ran with. And then, yeah, just some of the techniques and processes I used along the way. Let's go. So in front of me, this is like the first idea that I had. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to quickly show you guys this sample. I'm just going to quick just get rid of all of that. Extend it and just get rid of these. Cool. So this is the initial sample that I found off of a mixtape, and I kind of wanted to build a track around the back of that. So I'll give you guys a little play of this.
I've seen 357s, I've seen 12 gauge shotguns, I've seen 12 gauge pumps, 8 shooters, I've seen 45 military special with clip on the street, I've seen fucking Thompsons, damn Thompson, I seen them shit, man. I've seen hand grenades, I've seen beer can bazookas made. Damn things hit you just as getting hit with a gun. I've seen 22 zip guns, I've seen 38 zip guns, I've seen, I'll tell you, this is about things that you think you never see on the street. I've seen dynamite on the street. I've seen all of this. You'd be surprised, man. Pretty soon they're gonna steal the damn atom bomb.
So when I heard that sample for the first time, I was like, that sample's fucking sick. I wanna use it for a track. And at the time I really wanted to build like a dubstep track around it. So I can get rid of this now. So what I kind of did, I kind of chopped it up a little bit, as you can kind of see, just so that it can fit into the 32 bar. And then I added this audio effect rack, which I kind of made from scratch. And all it is just a delay. So I used this Saphir delay, which is like a really decent, like easy to use delay. Sometimes I use it for like creative purposes. This PSP digital reverb is kind of like an emulation almost of like old school kind of analog rack reverbs. Again, just another one of those kind of plugins. You just put it on and straight away it sounds good. Then after that, I use a compressor just so that that wet signal can be more consistent. And yeah, it just kind of sounds level throughout. So also I added this pitch shifter. And I also added the soft tube saturator as well. So what you might hear when I play the track is that the vocal is being automated to kind of go up and down in pitch. And yeah, I kind of heard it on a few kind of like weird glitch hip hop tracks. And it was a kind of effect which I wanted to recreate for myself.
I've seen 357s, I've seen 12 gauge shotguns, I've seen 12 gauge pumps, 8 shooters, I've seen 45 military special with clip on the street, I've seen fucking Thompsons,
damn Thompson, I've seen
them shit, man. I've seen hand grenades, I've seen beer can bazookas, man.
I've seen 22 zip codes, I've seen 30 zip codes,
I'll tell you, it's about things that you think you never see on the street, I've seen.
as you could see in my automation, you can see that there's also this, it says chain selector, but it's basically just like the wet being applied, and we're just hearing more of this delay and reverb being introduced into this vocal sample alongside with this like, yeah, automation of the pitch. And then off the back of that, I kind of started making, I'm not going to go too deep onto this, just because I realized that I did change the tune quite a lot, but I still kept a couple elements, a couple core elements the same. But I just quick show you my kind of thought process when I first made this. So yeah, I wanted to kind of, like I said, I wanted to make like a little dubstep kind of sounding track. I mean, yeah, nothing really special going on here. My sub bass, I made this using Massive. So I just use like, it's kind of those kind of like vowel pulse to saw waves. So I use two of those. I kind of offsetted the pitch just so I can get a little bit of phase, just so I can get a little bit of width out of it as well. And then I used the square to saw wave, brought it down an octave with like a low pass cutoff. And that's pretty much it. And then I kind of just got, that's going to be exactly the same, but the only difference is I just added a little extra saturation to it. I just used a bandpass just so that I can kind of just get those upper harmonics. And then I just used the T-Rex. I just used the T-Rex clipper as well. So that's all what I kind of got going on with my bass for this version of the track. And then when I get to the second 16, I change it slightly. And then I use the Monarch from Native Instruments. Oops. So I'm using a Monarch from Native Instruments, and I'm kind of just getting, just like this more kind of like square wave, this kind of saw square wave going on alongside. And then there's this other little bit I kind of want to show you, even though I muted it within the track. So I thought at the time that was pretty cool. So what I did, I created a drum rack, and let me just mute these. I created a drum rack, and then I added these kind of like drum sounds where it's just from like a sample pack of just like metallic drums. I think they just got like a drummer to kind of just like record and perform using like weird objects like barrels and metal sheet plates and stuff like that. And then alongside that, I used this plugin in Reactor. So this plugin, Molecular, if I be 100% honest, I don't use it a lot, and when I do use it, I have little to no idea what the fuck I'm doing. It's one of those kind of plugins I kind of just throw on and I hope for the best. And luckily, every time I've used it so far, I've been able to get some really interesting sounds. This patch that I used and slightly tweaked, not a lot, is very simple. It's just a flanger, a reverb, and a type of resonator. And yeah, overall, I kind of made this track. I can bring it back. Overall, I kind of made this track, and it feels pretty stale, if I'll be honest. I give it another little playback. I mean, even the drums that I created. Thank you. yeah, I just felt that like there wasn't really enough excitement in this track. This track did get used in the end for a project for a friend, for one of their kind of like installations. But yeah, overall, it just wasn't really hitting the mark for me. And in the end, it kind of just sat there. So I'm going to show you where I took this track next. Cool. So in front of me, this is the final version. I kind of, usually I have like A version, B version, C version. But when I was making this track, I did get quite a lot of the bulk done. And I just kept saving over it. So there's not really a lot of different versions showing my full work process. So I was working on this EP for Ivy Lab's 2020 label. And in the end, nothing really came out of it at the time. But this is one of the tracks that I was making for it. You might have heard this track be played in one of my radio sets. I know Ivy Labs as well played it during their Global 2020 sets on YouTube. And yeah, when I made this track, I kind of wanted to kind of just like, yeah, just explore other sounds. So the main thing was is that I still wanted to use that I've seen sample and build another kind of track around that a little bit. So what I did, I'm not sure if some of you are aware, but in Ableton, what you can do, if you can locate your projects, so I've, in my places, I've made it so that Ableton Live, so my Ableton Live projects are available, well, the ones that are on this hard drive, and you can go to a previous project, and when you open it up, it will show you what's inside that folder. So this is the project file at the time, and then what you can do, there'll be a drop down, and then you can open up the drop down for that project file, and then it shows you all the stems, all the tracks within that project, and you can literally just click and drag it. So it's almost like copy and pasting from one project to another. But when you do this, it also includes all the plugins you've used, all the data involved on that track. So the plugins, any automation, and it just makes it like a seamless transaction from one project to the other. So I pretty much did that when transferring the vocal over to this new project. So if we have a listen, if I can find it. So what I've done, so you can see that I've got like three different versions of this vocal. So the main vocal that I did transfer over is like these two. So you can still see that I still got my sound shifter, I still got the saturator, and I also still have this wet and dry like delay and reverb. Only difference is that I've taken a snippet of it, I've then copied it all over, bounced it down into place to create this one track down here so that I can then add further processing. So I'll give you guys a little play. Right, so we won't go too deep into it. We're kind of gonna, yeah, just go over this in a linear process. So back to the vocals. So what I've just done, like I kind of mentioned, I took a snippet of it, copied it and pasted it, glued it all together so that it's all one piece, and then added this series of automation. So if I show you all the automation that's going on here. It doesn't really feel like a massive amount, if I be 100% honest. So we've got a bit of automation on my EQ. So you might have seen it while the track was playing, but this band down here was opening up so we can hear more of the vocal. The wet of the reverb was increasing while the dry of the reverb was decreasing, and then halfway through the middle, I was increasing the K rate of the reverb. So that was all of these is kind of happening just to kind of just like, yeah, help the whole transaction from the intro to the drop of the track. So another bit in the intro, which I kind of wanted to show you guys as well, if I just create a fresh audio track and copy this over. So in a previous video, I've mentioned a few times that I enjoy making like weird elements using like VCV racks. And yeah, it kind of helps me just make these kind of like tones and textures, which I normally wouldn't like discover or find. And yeah, I use them as like layers within like my intros. And sometimes, yeah, they find themselves in the main part of the track. So I did a similar thing. So I'll give you a play of this loop first. So what I did to create that, there's this plugin from Native Instruments in Reactor. It's an old plugin, I must admit. And yeah, I just use it for like a lot of my weird textures and noises sometimes. So if I open up play, so it's this thing here. So metaphysical, you got function A and function B. I think the only difference between the two is just presets. They're both pretty much exactly the same. From my understanding, it's just that, yeah, one has a different set of presets and the other has a different set of other presets. So So what this is like a sound generator. It uses both oscillators and samples. I'm gonna hit solo so we can hear it. And yeah, what I do a lot of the time, I just sit here, I record it back in through Ableton, and while it's recording, I might just hit randomize. So as you can hear, but like, you know, these sounds can be very extreme or very subtle. And yeah, some of them are just like really crazy. You can get some really interesting, really like obscure elements out of this. You know, that sounds amazing. That would be something that would end up in a track. This is like, yeah, one of my little secret weapons, I guess, one of my go-tos for, again, like creating and adding texture to my track. So I did that, recorded that into Ableton, and then once I recorded it into Ableton, I recorded it through my delay pedal. I want to kind of give you guys like a little, hopefully you can see that clearly enough and it focuses in properly. So this pedal from Mooer is one of those kind of it's one of those kind of things which is like cheap and cheerful, and you buy it and it ends up like just being one of your go-to things. And I used it a fair bit within this track. Again, just kind of trying to create some weird bits. And I'm not sure if you can see, but so you've got three options up here. So you've got analog function, you've got tape echo function, and you've got real echo, and they all sound like really good. I use the tape echo function the most. But yeah, it's one of those, like I said, man, it's just like, I think I paid like 60 quid for it. And ever since, I just use it a lot. I just throw it in into a lot of my tracks to kind of, create some weird elements. So yeah, making that kind of like this effect in the end was just a recorded pad from Metaphysical with the Mooer delay pedal. So and then straight away again. So this element is done exactly the same way. So if I unbypass this and I play this to you. So this sound was created off of the back of this. And I can't tell you, I couldn't tell you where the original sound comes from. A friend of mine showed me loads of like these kind of like, I guess, sound artists, rather than producers. They kind of just create sounds from obscure sound sources. And yeah, there's this album from this artist, and I kind of sieved through the track, managed to like zone in on one little bit. I mean, if I zoom out, you can see that I probably only just used a tiny snippet. That's not even it. Well, there we go. You can see that I only used like a tiny snippet from the track. And I kind of like the sound of it. It kind of reminded me of just like glasses and marbles and stuff. So I made this melody, and same thing as I did with the pad, ran it through my delay pedal. While it's looped up and playing, I'm playing around with the controls. So I'm changing the feedback and changing the delay time. I'm changing the reverb. I'm changing the reverb level. And then, I came up with this. Cool. So I can deactivate that again. So let's talk about this melody now. So the melody I created using Reactor again, but the plugin within Reactor I used is this bad boy here called Razor. So if I play you this soloed version, so what Reactor is an additive synth. For those of you that may not be clued up on your different types of synthesis, so you've got additive, subtractive, wavetable, FM, and I think that's the main ones, to be honest. I guess you've got like hybrid as well, where it uses like a combination of one or two of them, but they're gonna be like your main types of synth. So the most typical one is your subtractive synthesis. So this is something like your analog synths, where you would have different types of wave shapes, so like square wave, sine wave, triangle, saw. And what you do, you use these waves which has a range of harmonics in it, or a lot of these waves kind of have like loads of harmonics. So something like a square wave and a saw wave will come to mind when you think of harmonics and frequencies. And then what you do, you shave away the undesired frequencies and harmonics from this sound to create something which you want. So the way you would normally do that is by using like a filter and envelopes, and then you kind of have your desired sound. What this does as an additive synth, you kind of go the other way around. So you're kind of like starting from like a singular harmonic, and then you're slowly adding more harmonics into your sound, and then that's how you're kind of creating your desired sound of effect. So yeah, think of it almost like subtractive, like you've got like a statue, you've got like a piece of marble, and you've got your hammer and chisel, and you chisel away until you get the statue, or you get the figurine, what the fuck am I on about? You chisel away until you get the object that you want, whereas additive is that like you're slowly just adding, almost like a clay model, you're slowly adding bits onto it until you get the shape and sound that you want. One of the beauties about this synth, which was why I kind of use it a lot for like my plucks and plucks and bell sounds and stuff like that, this thing here called the dissonance effects. This is kind of the part where I start to get a lot of the character into the sound design whenever I use it. Could show you quickly like what some of these other bits will sound like. And yeah, it's just something I've never really seen before in a synth. And then on top of that is this reverb synced. Honestly, it's like one of like the best reverbs I've seen built in on a synth. And if that reverb was a standalone feature, I probably would use it on almost everything. It's one of my favorite features of this synth. And one of my favorite sounding reverbs, if I be totally honest. I kind of like played around with it until I kind of got this sound. And then what I did once the track dropped, so once I got to the 16th bar, I automated the reverb, so the wet and dry of the reverb, just to kind of have like a higher percentage of wet. And then, just to kind of switch up the sound a little bit so it didn't really sound like it's just the same thing. And it kind of gave it that more kind of like ghost, that kind of ghostly, kind of more like distant kind of sound. Honestly, that reverb pretty much made that track, hands down. So let's play that in context of everything else. So as you can hear, in comparison to the initial version of the track where I used this vocal sample, I kept it going throughout the drop rather than having the track kind of just like drop and then the vocal kind of like be muted. And then, this effect, so this was taken from the original idea. I forgot to show it to you guys, but all I kind of did was just add this kind of like telephone effect onto it. What I did with this EQ, I got that same Sphere delay back on, and then I just gave it a little boost using like this Gleam, the utility plugin. Let's have a look at these drums. So my drums, as some of you would have seen before, I use my kick in the sampler. So just here's my kick here with my kind of like little pitch envelope, just so I can get a little bit more bite into it. I got these snares, I ended up just like bouncing into one clip. And then, yeah, just the rest of my like claps and snares. Just, So as I kind of mentioned, again, loads of times I like to do this whole kind of little TikTok vibe with my sounds. So I have one at one semitone. So this one's like down here, like minus three semitones. And then the next one is at minus six. And then I just copy and paste that. And then, yeah, that just kind of adds like a little groove to the track. And, you know, I kind of do that a lot with my snares as well. So some of these snares will be like different semitones. I think I bought. So yeah, as you can kind of see, but like, yeah, I just changed the pitch on quite a few of these snares. So even like on my main snares, this is at like zero semitones, but on this one, this one's like minus one. This one's like minus two. I've been back to zero. So again, it's just like, just so that like each snare is not exactly the same. They sound similar and it's not that much difference, but it's just like, yeah, just adding just that a little bit of just like, I guess, humanization to it. You know, I try to imagine that like when somebody's playing their drums, they're not hitting the snare exactly the same time. They're not hitting the snare at the same velocity, so that means that the pitch of the snare is not going to be exactly the same. They're not a robot, and I want to try to like get rid of that whole kind of roboticness in my music. So this is just kind of like one of the ways that I go about that. Same with like what I kind of mentioned before with the whole kind of TikTok vibe. I've got that going on with my hi-hats. So I've got this top layer here which is like at the correct pitch. And that's kind of mainly doing like the main kind of like melody of the hi-hats. And then underneath, I kind of still got that whole kind of like, yeah, like I said, TikTok. I need to kind of like figure out another name for this technique that I use. I'm not really rating calling it TikTok, to be honest. But yeah, kind of just got it going at like the same sort of pace, just varying in one semitone, just so that it's not exactly the same. And then alongside that, we got this loop from my sample pack, from the Thailand sample pack, Street Food, that I made a while back. And then, and that's just adding just like a nice little texture underneath the drums. And, you know, it's kind of one of those kind of things about like happy accidents. You know, there's little grooves on here which like ain't exactly on time. It kind of sounds a little bit more pitched down because I guess it had to kind of like, yeah, be changed to fit the tempo of the track. But yeah, all of those like little elements and artifacts within that loop which ain't exactly on beat, but still kind of like, but overall the whole loop is still in time. They're the kind of stuff that adds that nice kind of just like, yeah, like I said, just like groove within your drum loops. Cool. So yeah, let's get to the fun bit. So let's have a look at my bass. So the bass I made using wavetables. So the main part of the bass, I say it's nothing exciting. So all it is just like a sine wave and a saw wave. And then what I've kind of done is just add an envelope to the pitch so that that initial hit, it kind of like starts at a higher pitch and then comes back down to the correct pitch that's being played at. And then I also added this envelope onto my amp. So I've got short attack, short decay. I made the sustain lower by like 3 decibels and then like, yeah, a short release. So in my head, I'm kind of thinking that I want that initial hit just to kind of have a bit of crunch to it, have a little bit of bite to it. But if I wanted to sustain the note, it can like be sustained at a slightly lower decibel just so that it's not overpowering all the other elements within the track. And then alongside that, I kind of added a fair bit of drive to each filter. So each oscillator is being sent to its own independent filter. And then I added another saturator at the end of that. And then I got like a glue compressor being sidechained to the kick. So if I solo this bass, you should be able to hear the bass dip every time the kick plays. Cool. And that's just helped creating a space for, yeah, my kick. And then the top layer. So it's pretty much exactly the same patch. Only difference is that I use 2 saw waves rather than a sine and a saw wave. And then I also added some unison to it. And I open up the filters a bit more just so that we can get those upper harmonics, which is being saturated. And then I use the EQ just to make sure that there's no sub frequencies being played. And then rather using a saturator, I used good old trusty sausage fattener just to add some thickness and some color and some distortion to it. And then finally, my glue compressor being sidechained to the kick. So both of those being played together gave me, yeah, my bass in the track, and then in context with the rest of the track. So I get like that body and that weight from the low end, but on the top end, I still get that width as if it's like a re-space kind of thing, almost as if like sick, like you're getting those upper, yeah, you're getting that width and yeah, those harmonics, but I still got that low end just like thumping through the middle of my speakers. So think what else I got going on here. So in the second part, I slightly change the bass. So what I've done is pretty much the same patch again, but with this one. I kept the low end the same, but I just wanted like a kind of wall of sound. So I kind of changed the other saw wave to kind of go in between the saw and the triangle wave. And then the second oscillator, I just used noise. And I was just like, cool. I just want it to be thick. I wanted to just sound. I really wanted it to sound like it's being pushed through a guitar amp, but it's not. And yeah, I kind of just opened up the EQ a little bit just so I can still kind of get some more of those frequencies through. And then, yeah, still with the sausage fattener and the sidechain. And then, as you can hear, there's kind of like that little glass melody, there's little from that weird kind of like abstract track, which I resampled, kind of came in, and this is almost like a percussive element just supporting everything that's going on. Because I've got like so much noise in the space, I had to like strip the drums back a little bit. But what I took away, I kind of also replaced a little bit with this melody. 45. So after that, it kind of goes back into like seen show kind of vibe. 57s,
I seen 12 gauge.
And when I was creating this, I was listening to a lot of like Ghost Mane at the time. So rather than the second drop being the same as the first, I kind of changed it a bit just so that, like, yeah, I wanted the track to feel progressive and I didn't want it to feel that like I'm just doing a copy and paste job. So yeah, I switched up the drum pattern a little bit, and I switched up the bass pattern as well to kind of like, yeah, it almost feels that it's like a different BPM, potentially a bit slower. But yeah, like I said, I was listening to a lot of Ghost Mane at the time, so that kind of influenced this kind of style of the second drop. And then what I also did, I wanted to introduce another sound, but I didn't know where to get the sound from. So I resampled the pad, and that's what kind of got me this. So if you remember when I showed you the pad that I created, this is what it sounded like. And it's exactly the same thing, just being played a bit faster. Have another listen. What if I just quick bring up this sampler so you can see. So you can see it's the same patch. Whoops. And then, yeah. Key. I just found the key, which kind of just like, yeah, fit with the rest of the tempo of the track. And then, yeah, just kind of just use that. And again, I feel like I've mentioned it before, but sometimes, like, if you hit a wall and you want to like introduce other elements into your track, but you don't know where to go, just resample what you've already created. You know, like that pad, getting that pad initially, it wasn't just like one preset. It was like a series of steps to get that. So there was a series of creative decisions that kind of got me something which is unique to this track that I'm making. And why stop there? And that's what I did. I just kind of resampled it, and it just sounds like a whole nother element, even though it's exactly the same thing. And then, yeah, that kind of just continues. And then the pad that I resampled just kind of like grows back in, and then it goes into the outro. So once I got to that point of the track, and I kind of got my arrangement how I like, really and truly, at this kind of stage, I hit a point where I was like, I don't know what to do. And if I carry on, I could potentially spoil the track. So I bounced out the stems, I put them all into Logic, I started mixing down, and I started automating and processing all the stems so that they can just fit and be balanced and, yeah, kind of like make sense to each another. And yeah, I created a version, a bounceable, I created a playable version and a pre-master, and I sent it off for it to be considered for this EP I was working on at the time. And yeah, it got the okay. And then I played it to my uncle, and my uncle liked the track. Well, he actually kind of loves it a bit, to be honest. But he kind of mentioned to me that he felt that, like, the second drop, he said I was doing too much. He said that the second drop is unnecessary. And even though I was happy with myself that it felt progressive, he kind of talked me back into just making the second drop the same as the first, because he was kind of just saying that that's where the vibe is. So on the version that will be released, the second drop will be the same as the first. However, what I'm going to do, I'm going to make this version available for you guys. And yeah, you guys can have it so that you can play out or whatever. I'm going to call this the progressive version or whatever. But I can show you that mixed down at a later stage. But I hope that, you know, you guys can kind of see that sometimes you might have an idea and it might not work, but don't just let it sit there on your hard drive. Don't be afraid to kind of pick parts from the idea which you really liked, even though in my case it was just a vocal sample that helped me kind of create this tune, which is a tune I'm pretty happy with. So yeah, I hope there were some processes which you guys might want to try out for yourself, or there might be some plugins I've used which you guys might want to explore. But yeah, that's kind of like how I got from one sample to one track to another track, and yeah, finally something which is worthy of being released. So I hope that was useful to you guys, and yeah, I'll see you guys next time.